This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Juan Gonzalez. Welcome to all of our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. 5 years ago, the Supreme Court handed down its Citizens United decision, striking down the prohibition on corporate expenditures in federal elections. The court's 5-4 decision opened the floodgates for corporate and undisclosed dark money to pour into the election process. According to the Center for Responsive Politics, the number of donors giving more than $1 million to outside groups during elections has grown from 2 in 2006 to 84 in the 2014 congressional elections. The right-wing Koch brothers have pledged to use their network of conservative advocacy groups to spend a staggering $900 million in advance of the 2016 presidential election.
In the Citizens United case, the Supreme Court ruled corporations are people with the same right to influence politics as voters. Meanwhile, many corporations, including McDonald's, Monsanto, and Peabody Energy, have cited the principle of corporate constitutional rights in recent efforts to fight back against new laws. McDonald's and other franchises are now suing the city of Seattle over its new $15-an-hour minimum wage law, arguing it violates its corporate personhood rights. On Tuesday, the International Franchise Association told a federal judge that the law unfairly discriminates against franchise owners by treating them differently than local small business proprietors. They're basing their case on the 14th Amendment, a constitutional provision written to protect newly freed slaves after the Civil War and ensure equal rights for all people. Monsanto is challenging Vermont's recently passed GMO labeling law under the First Amendment, claiming it forces them to speak against their will. Today, we host a debate. Joining us from Watertown, Massachusetts, is Ron Fine, legal director of the organization Free Speech for People, which backs a constitutional amendment to overturn the doctrine of corporate constitutional rights. And in Boston, we're joined by Kent Greenfield. He's a professor of law and Dean's Research Scholar at Boston College Law School. He recently wrote a piece for The Washington Monthly called Let Us Now Praise Corporate Persons. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Ron Fine, let's begin with you. Explain what is meant by corporate personhood.
Well, thank you, Amy and Juan, and thanks also to Professor Greenfield, who I do have great respect for as an expert in state corporations law. But we're talking now about the Constitution. The idea of corporate personhood is a doctrine that comes out originally of state law, and it enables a corporation to have some of the legal rights of people when we deem that it is appropriate for them to do so. So, for example, a corporation can own property, sell property, sue, and be sued. And that's all good. But when we're talking about the Constitution, that metaphor of the corporation as a person becomes extremely dangerous because it leads to fuzzy thinking. And that's why we see things like the Equal Protection Clause cases, where corporations are claiming that regulations about the minimum wage that treat certain types of corporations differently from others are a form of discrimination that we should be concerned about. And similarly, under the First Amendment, we see also corporations using the metaphor of personhood to refuse to speak as if they were a dissenting religious minority when what's being asked of them is to disclose information about what's in the products that they sell. So when you take that metaphor of corporate personhood from its origins in state law and you transpose it onto the Constitution, it becomes extremely dangerous. And that's why we've seen a sustained and renewed assault on laws ranging from minimum wage to genetically engineered food disclosure to disclosure of products coming from war-torn regions of Central Africa to a St. Louis, Missouri ballot initiative that seeks only to end public tax breaks for fossil fuel producers and is also being challenged as violating the Equal Protection Clause.
Well, Kent Greenfield, could you lay out why you believe that expansion of corporate personhood would actually bring more accountability by corporations?
Sure, Juan. And again, thank you for inviting me on. And I I'll say hello to Ron Fine, whose work I respect quite a bit. So I think, well, first of all, I should say that I think the examples that you raised so far in this segment about the Seattle minimum wage and some of the forced disclosure laws, I think the corporation should lose in those cases. My point is that corporate personhood is often misunderstood, and Ron is correct that for the most part, corporate personhood is simply just another way of saying that corporations ought to be separate legal entities, and that's a wonderful thing. It bolsters the ability, the legal ability, to hold corporations accountable. Think about the BP oil spill from several years ago, 2010. If the corporation itself was not a legal entity, it would be hard to hold anybody accountable. It would be hard to hold the individuals involved. Certainly, don't have deep enough pockets to pay back the horrible damage that was caused there. I think where Ron and I would disagree is that whether corporations should be able to ever assert any constitutional rights. And I think that some constitutional rights, some of the time, are appropriate for corporations to assert. I mean, and the easiest example is, of course, media corporations. The New York Times, a media conglomerate, certainly ought to have First Amendment rights. That's an easy case. I think the harder cases are what to do about election spending and the like, and in those cases, I think as Amy suggested at the beginning of the segment, I think the torrent of money going independent money going into politics these days is a danger to democracy, but I think the danger is money, whether it comes from corporations or individuals, and most of the money that we're seeing actually in politics these days is coming from rich individuals, not corporations.
So what you're really debating is whether a constitutional amendment should be put forward. But before we talk about that, I wanted to ask Kent Greenfield on this issue, for example, of the law of the suit that was heard this week. Explain what's happening. Why is McDonald's, the other corporations, Comfort Inn, Holiday Inn, why are they suing the Seattle over the Seattle's minimum wage hike to $15 an hour? Explain what it's all about.
I've heard about that case, but
Ron Fine,
maybe Ron Fine knows more about it.
Yes, thank you. I'd be happy to explain. We filed a friend of the court brief in that case. The claim that is being brought by the International Franchise Association against Seattle's new $15 an hour living wage law is that the schedule for implementation treats franchised businesses unfairly because it phases them in at a different schedule than local small businesses. So they have to comply with the law at a different time. And the reason for that was the Seattle City Council studied the issue and they determined that, for example, a McDonald's restaurant with 50 employees is not really comparable to a small independent restaurant with 50 employees because it gets the benefits of coordinated marketing and advertising and product development and bulk purchase agreements that a independent restaurant doesn't get. That's the basis for their claim. Now, they've challenged the Seattle Living Wage Law under a whole kitchen sink of theories. One of them is the Equal Protection Clause, and that clause is part of the 14th Amendment, which was designed to protect the rights of the freed slaves after the Civil War. And it is good that the Equal Protection Clause has expanded in recent years to protect additional categories of people, like gay and lesbian Americans, as we've seen in the marriage equality movement. But it was never intended to protect corporations. And in fact, our research has shown that the authors of the 14th Amendment in the 1860s, as Reconstruction was occurring in the South, were particularly concerned about whether the newly freed slaves were able to earn fair living wages. And the United States government took action leading up to the 14th Amendment to ensure that there were fair living wages available for the freed slaves as they continued working in the South. So the corporate claims under the Equal Protection Clause came from after the Civil War, when the Supreme Court determined with no evidence or interpretation whatsoever that when the Equal Protection Clause says that a state cannot deny the equal protection of the laws to any persons within its jurisdiction, that persons includes corporations. And the Supreme Court then used this as a tool throughout the Gilded Age in the late 19th century and early 20th century to strike down minimum wage laws, child labor laws, and a host of other laws. And that continued until the New Deal, when finally FDR, with the public at his back, stood up to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court backed down. And that led to the post-war era of the 1940s, 50s, and 60s, when corporations were not asserting any constitutional claims, by and large, and yet we had the greatest shared economic prosperity of this country in generations.
So McDonald's is comparing itself to freed slaves?
In essence.
And then just the Vermont case, Monsanto challenging Vermont's recently passed GMO labeling law under the First Amendment, claiming it forces them to speak against their will.
Yes, this is a line of cases known as compelled speech. And it starts with the 1940s, where the Supreme Court held that Jehovah's Witnesses shouldn't be forced to recite the Pledge of Allegiance against their will because it violates their human dignity. In recent years, the courts have begun extending that same principle to corporations. But corporations are artificial entities created by state laws. They're not endowed by their creator with inalienable rights. They're endowed by state laws with specific rights provided in their charters. But the courts have now been granting the right to avoid disclosure of product ingredients to corporations. And so when Monsanto and other grocery food manufacturers are challenging Vermont's law, saying that they do not wish to reveal whether their products contain genetically engineered ingredients or not, they're actually standing on some recent Supreme Court First Amendment precedent that's in their favor. And unfortunately, as our legal advisor John Coates of Harvard Law School has shown, in recent years there's been a corporate takeover of the First Amendment, where an increasing percentage of the court's First Amendment dockets are occupied now by corporate claims of this type.
Well, Ron Fine and Ken Greenfield, we have to break. We're going to come back to our discussion and focus on the constitutional amendment movement, how that would affect corporations and regular, everyday people. This is Democracy Now! We'll be back in a minute.